It's my pleasure to inform you that we have Barbara Chandler, who's a dementia care trainer with CaringKind, and Amy Torres, who's the director of training at CaringKind, and Juan Carlos Rojas, who is a dementia care trainer at CaringKind, who will be conducting this afternoon sessions on enhancing communication, managing challenging behaviors, and creating meaningful activities. So it's my pleasure, without further ado, to turn the floor over to Barbara Chandler.
Thank you. What a nice greeting. Good afternoon, everybody. Hopefully you had a nice lunch, but I don't know, too full, and hopefully I can keep you awake. As Mr. Kudish said, I'm a dementia care trainer. Can you all hear me?
No.
Okay, I'll speak closer to the mic. A dementia care trainer for CaringKind New York City. And I primarily do training with family caregivers, but I've also done some training with the professional caregivers. I understand there are about half of you who are family caregivers and half of you who are professional caregivers. Professionals working in the field of aging. So today I'm going to be speaking to you about strategies for effective communication. Communicating with people with dementia can be very challenging, as I'm sure many of you are aware, both for the person with dementia and for those that are caring for them. It's important, really important, to remember that, as was discussed this morning, it's a disease that is causing these challenging changes in communication skills, and it's something that the person with dementia can't control. It's not within their control. It can really be helpful to have that in your mind when you're working with people. These changes can include problems including the right word, losing a train of thought, and also difficulty understanding what words mean. Yes, I do, but I wasn't. Yeah, sure, I'll advance. Okay. And people with dementia are often really frustrated with, I'm sorry, I have to get used to talking to the mic, often frustrated with this communication when it isn't working. And often that leads to many of the behavior challenges that we see, which is something that will be discussed in the next presentation in more detail. So today, again, I'm going to be speaking to you about these strategies, and one of the first things that that's really important for you to remember is how you present yourself when you're working with someone with dementia or your family member with dementia. You need to be aware of your emotions at that time, because research has shown that people with dementia do maintain a very strong sense of emotional intelligence. So they can read our moods, they read our body language very well. So if you are rushing in to see somebody, you know, it took you a long time to get there, you're a little bit late, you're feeling anxious and frustrated, If you're feeling that way, they may pick up on that, and it may affect their mood as well. So it's really important to try, wherever possible, to bring yourself into a more calm, upbeat state of mind when you're dealing with somebody with dementia. Okay. There are various things that you can do to maximize communication with someone with dementia. You need to consider a number of factors. First of all, you want to make sure that it's an environment that is making it as easy as possible for the communication to go well. So one of the things you want to be sure of is that the person doesn't have a hearing impairment or a vision impairment that may not have been addressed. Maybe they need glasses, maybe they need a hearing aid. They may have a hearing aid, but they may not have it turned on. So that's something that you want to be aware of. But also, when you're speaking with somebody with dementia, you want to make sure you're also speaking loudly enough and clearly. People with dementia also have issues with vision, such as losses in their peripheral vision, so that somebody in the early stages of dementia, basically what they're able to see, if you put your hands up as though you had a goggle over your eyes, that's their field of vision in early stage. In middle stage, it's decreased to the point that it's more like if someone had binoculars on. So if you put your hands like this for a minute and just try to get a sense of how little you can actually see to your left, to your right, up, down. So you certainly wouldn't want to approach somebody with dementia from behind. Even from the sides, they're not going to see you. What you do with someone with dementia is you want to approach them from the front, and you want to make sure that you're in there, you have them in your field of vision, and they can see you. You're in their field of vision. So another thing you want to do when you're dealing with somebody with dementia is to limit distractions. You want to make sure if you're trying to communicate with them that you don't have a lot of background noise, if you can control it, but certainly something like a loud television set or a radio playing, because this can be confusing and distracting to somebody with dementia. And you should also take into account the time of day. There are certain times of day that things are harder for a lot of people with dementia. I'm sure many of you have heard of sundowning, which is something that happens to a lot of people with dementia as it goes into the early evening, from early evening into nighttime, and often people get agitated and sometimes aggressive at that point in time. So you want to consider if there's something you need them to do, that you are... you are picking a time of day. Hopefully, you probably know your person, and when they're in a better state and when they're more alert, oftentimes this is after they've had breakfast or lunch, and approach them about something that you need them to do at the time when you think they're most likely to be receptive to it. So you want to keep those kinds of things in mind. Okay. You also, there are cues that you can use to assist somebody in communicating with you, somebody who's losing their language abilities or the ability to follow and understand what you're saying to them verbally. You can use physical cues. If you want them, it's time to eat, and you want them you want to get attention on the food, you can point to the food and say, "Your lunch is ready. Here's your sandwich and your drink." You can also use written notes if it's somebody who's in an earlier stage and can still read. If not, then you can use pictures. There are various types of cues. Types of cues as I'm discussing. The visual cues would be you could use pictures to identify for someone the bathroom. If they're able to read, obviously you can just identify it, write it, a note that's saying this is the bathroom. Or you could use a picture of a toilet, and that cues them that that's the door, that's the room, that's the bathroom. You can also... use verbal cues, and that can include walking somebody through what you need them to do. People with dementia are not able to follow detailed instructions. So if you're asking them to get dressed, you're asking them to bathe or brush their teeth, just asking them to do that is not something that they're going to be able to do at this point. So you will want to walk them through step by step. So, for instance, if you want them to brush their teeth, you can say, let's go brush your teeth. You can use the tactile cue of taking their hand and helping lead them to the bathroom. You may want to set things up in advance. You may want to already have the toothbrush and the toothpaste and whatever's needed out. You can then walk them through whatever they're actually able to do. You want to let them participate in activities like this could be an activity, in things that they are able to do. You know, allow them to continue to do the things that they can do, but they're going to start needing assistance as the disease progresses. So you may have to walk them again step by step through. So if you're brushing the teeth, you may need to say, you need to take your toothbrush and we need to put some toothpaste on the toothbrush. They may not be able to follow that, so you may need to do this with them and model this for them and take them through all of the steps. Put the toothpaste under the water, bring the toothbrush to your mouth, and describe each step of the process for them. And again, it may be best if you do this along with them. You can also use written cues. I've talked about that before. You could, if somebody's in earlier stage and they're able to read and they're still able to do many things, you may be able to identify, put a sticky note on a toaster oven, for instance, and explain how to, you know, the steps for using the toaster oven or a microwave. In a later stage, they're not, in the middle stage, they're not going to be able to read that, they're not going to be able to follow that, but you can use these, again, for earlier stage. There are also tactile cues that you can use, and that has to do, obviously, with touch. If you want to get them, for instance, to go to the kitchen to eat, you might say, come on, Dad, take their hand. Let's go over here. Let's walk them to the kitchen. And then you could say, let's eat, and use a gentle touch on the shoulder to get their attention when you're saying their name. And one of the other cues that you can use is gestures. So smiles, hugs, things that let them know that you're with them, you're caring for them, go a long way in keeping their mood good and in encouraging them. If there are things that you're trying to get them to do with you, they're more likely to be willing to do that. You can also give them a pat on the back when they've done something that you've asked them. You can ask them to help fold the laundry, or you might ask them to help peel potatoes, and just, you know, thank them. Make sure you give them some praise, sincere praise, and tactile, using a gesture such as patting them on the back, thank you. It makes them feel good. It's a nice thing. In terms of verbal communication, you need to go slow with people with dementia, and you need to give them time. So you need to ask one question at a time. Don't ask a series of questions, because by the time you get to two or three, they're not going to remember what the first question was. You also use, I have missed one. I'm going to go back for just a second to the verbal communication. You should always use their name and identify yourself. Don't assume that they will definitely know who you are. Remember, they may emotionally realize who you are, but not, you may be the daughter and they may no longer realize or have the concept of daughter, but they know, they recognize you as someone that they're happy to see. So you want to say something like, hi, B, it's your daughter, Anne, and I'm coming to see you and visit, and I'm so happy to see you. You look so lovely today, and start a conversation if you can. Take their hand, have tactile communication as well as verbal. Identify yourself, because they may not remember, and they may be embarrassed that they don't remember. So it's helpful if you can give them that. You want to do whatever you can to make things easier for them, because everything is really hard for somebody with dementia. You need to listen. when they're speaking, and make sure that you're making very good eye contact with them when they're speaking to you or you're speaking to them, especially if they're saying something to you and you want to use cues like nodding to let them know that you're with them, you're paying attention, you're listening. That's really important to somebody with dementia. Doesn't always happen. People can discount someone. So you want to make sure that they're important and that you're paying attention to them. You should always, again, speak slowly and clearly. Again, they need time to process what you're saying. You should give, again, single-step directions, as I spoke about earlier in terms of brushing teeth. You should also repeat things as necessary. It can get very frustrating at times, but they really can't help this because of their memory loss. So if you can try to remember that and try at least not to let them see your frustration, because it's hard for them, and they truly are asking again and again because they don't remember. Also, wait for a response from them. You want to make sure that you give them enough time to process what you're saying to them, and then you also need to give them time to try to formulate a response. So that can take time, and so patience is one of the most important pieces of working with somebody who's got a dementia. In terms of verbal communication, again, you should ask one, I started earlier, but one question at a time. State ideas in positive rather than negative ways, rather than don't go over there, say, why don't we go over here? Take them by the hand, smile, and say, why don't we go over here, and lead them somewhere other than where you don't want them to go. And you can also provide cues and also choice. It's really important to give people with dementia a choice within something that you need them to do. So if there's something that you need them to do, you need them to eat, you don't want to ask them, do you want to eat or when do you want to eat, an open-ended question. But you can say, we're going to eat now. What would you like? Would you prefer a tuna sandwich or a ham sandwich? So you're giving them some sense that they still have some control over things, because that's another thing that is happening for people with dementia. They're losing control over so many things in their lives that to give them the opportunity to at least have a choice can make them feel like they're being considered as a full person. You don't want to use reason or apply logic, because you probably heard that this morning, that they lose the ability to understand logic and reason. And also, you want to avoid open-ended questions, like, are you ready to, or do you want to, unless you're ready for a negative response, because they may say no, and then what did you do? So some examples of ways to rephrase questions would be things like, so do you want to wash up, which is open-ended, and instead you could say, let's wash up, and then we can go to the park. You can, to give them choice, instead of what would you like to wear today, which is again an open-ended question, you could say, would you like to wear this green shirt or this blue shirt? You might even have two shirts taken out of the closet so that they have the two to see and choose from. You can give them cues. So if there's a picture and you want to reminisce with them, and you're bringing them some pictures that you think will make them happy, if there's a baby in the photograph, they may not remember who that baby is. So you give them a cue. Is this your granddaughter, Jennifer, in the photograph? She's beautiful. So now they can respond. They could say yes or no. But they also, you've given them that information. And finally, in terms of not losing logic, using logic, instead of you know the toothpaste goes on your teeth, not in your hair, you could say, let's put the toothpaste here on the toothbrush, show them, and brush your teeth. Okay, as the disease progresses, it becomes more and more difficult for a person with dementia to use verbal language. So nonverbal communication becomes really important at this point. There are a variety of things that fall under that category. One is body language. Remember the person that we talked before, the person with dementia is very good at reading emotion, and that can be determined by body language. They can read your body language. So if you smile, but you're actually really feeling very tense about something, they may sense that that's not a real smile. And if you're in a hurry, they're gonna likely, and you're feeling anxious, they're likely gonna sense that, and they will potentially mirror that behavior. So again, where possible, try to greet them in a calm, gentle, relaxed manner, wherever possible. Again, it's important to approach from the front, and when you do, you can also offer them a hand. If you coming to see, let's see, I'm coming to see my mom. Hi, Mom, how are you today? I'm approaching her from the front. I'm looking her in the eye, and I'm putting out my hand to make a connection, an emotional and a nonverbal connection with her. And again, if I approach them from behind, what may happen if I call out to them or I put my hand on their shoulder, I could startle them because they don't know. Even if I've called from behind and said, hi, Mom, as I might have been able to in the past, they don't know where that's coming from. They don't even, that could be the television. So it can be disconcerting. You want to, again, maintain eye contact. So important, because that really makes them feel that you're listening to them, that you are giving them your time and your attention. And use visual and tactile cues, as we talked about earlier. Always go slow and smile wherever you can. Try to put yourself in a good frame of mind, because it really will make a difference in terms of their response and making it a positive interaction rather than something that's difficult. Oops. Excuse me. One more back. Okay. What you don't want to do, one of the most important things to remember, is don't argue with somebody with dementia. We really, their world and our world may be two different things, but they can't change the reality of their world. That is reality for them, whatever they're dealing with and however they're feeling. So you don't want to argue with them. You must really go into their world, agree with them. Nod if you don't want to, you know, say yes about something that's not true. You can just nod your head and show them you're listening and paying attention. You also don't want to rely on logic, because they're at this stage, they're no longer able to follow logic. Of course, you don't want to order them around. Nobody likes to be ordered around. We don't like to be ordered around. So that's something that's likely to anger and frustrate them. These are the kinds of things that lead to the behaviors that will be talked about next. You don't want to be condescending or sarcastic, and that can be tough at times, because it is a really trying to communicate with someone with dementia. Some of the behaviors that you're dealing with can be really difficult, and there are times that you're just tired and feeling like you don't have a lot of patience, and you may be thinking and, you know, feeling a little bit sarcastic or condescending, but don't keep that in check. Also, don't talk about a person with dementia in front of them to other people. Often people think, especially when somebody's no longer able to communicate through verbal communication, that the person doesn't know, you know, they don't know what's going on, so we can talk in front of them. I think a lot of people realize as they're doing it, they probably shouldn't be doing it. It doesn't quite feel right, but you're with somebody, you're with another family, another caregiver, and they start to talk about something that you're dealing with this person. So you want to have that conversation, and you sort of let it go, and you have it. But you may feel that you really probably shouldn't be, and you shouldn't be, because they very well may be able to understand what we're saying, know we're talking about them, just not able to verbalize to us that they know that. You don't want to quiz a person with dementia or test them, and you probably all realize why that is. Without with the memory issues, they don't remember, and to put them on the spot like that is likely, again, to cause a potential behavioral issue that could be out of frustration and can cause agitation and anger. You don't want to give too much detail, because again, they can only follow really one thing at a time. So break things down. If you're going to be telling them something that's going to be going on, first of all, you don't necessarily want to tell them too far in advance, because they might sort of obsess over what that is. But when you are telling them, maybe today we're getting dressed now because we're going to go to the doctor to just make sure that your health is good, you don't want to tell them too much detail. Don't give them too much. Keep it simple. One of the things we talk about is try to use 5-word sentences. Keep sentences short and concepts short. And you also don't want to give multiple part commands, and that's like the questions, multiple questions, the same concept, because they can't remember. They're going to forget by the second or third command what the first command was. So, again, it's just mostly important that you remember that this is something that is happening to them. It is affecting their ability to be able to communicate. Not being able to communicate well is really frustrating. It would be frustrating for any of us, and it's certainly frustrating for the person with dementia. So anything that we can do to make it easier for them and to help them is going to go a long way in making a much more pleasant interaction. So thank you. I'm now going to turn this over to Ms. Torres, who is going to be talking about behaviors. And we'll just take a short break. Okay.
Thank you for hanging in here today with us. Discussing dementia, discussing communication and behaviors with the person with dementia is sometimes a pretty hard listen. And we understand that here, so I'll try to make this as brief as possible. And also after this segment, you will have the opportunity to ask questions. So just hang in there for a couple more minutes. Thank you. So it's interesting, because in the realm of human existence, everyone exhibits behaviors. We all do it. We don't necessarily coin it behaviors, but we all exhibit behaviors. Oftentimes it depends on where we are. So our behavior at work is going to be very distinct than our behavior in our homes. True or not true? Yeah. Our behavior with certain coworkers is going to be very different than our behavior with our family, right? So we kind of develop different personas depending on where we are. And that's how we manage our lives. And it's okay, and it's expected. And when you see someone, a coworker, a colleague, or hopefully a family member, behaving in a certain way, you try to understand why they're behaving that way. And oftentimes, because our behavior will mimic their situation, we understand where they're coming from. There's commonality there, right? We have a social contract. They don't teach it to us in school, but there's certain rules and norms that pertain to every culture and environment. So at work, we expect people to behave a certain way. In our homes, we expect people to behave another way. And we're all comfortable with that, Now, where discomfort can begin is when people begin behaving away in a manner that we don't expect. That's when we get very anxious or agitated or fearful ourselves. And that's what begins to happen with people with dementia. They begin responding to a reality that we don't necessarily perceive. They begin breaking those rules of the social contract so that they're going to do things that we can't necessarily relate to. They're going to exhibit emotions in places that typically would be considered inappropriate. We have all heard of instances of people with dementia perhaps taking off their clothes in a place where they shouldn't take off their clothes. We've all heard instances when a person with dementia is going to perhaps not use the utensils in the restaurant. And not using the utensils in the restaurant is something that we generally don't do. We can do that at home, but we can't do that outside, right? Taking off our clothes in the middle of our living room, well, sometimes that's okay for people, but taking off our clothes in church is not, right? And these things begin to make us feel uncomfortable. And when a person's behavior makes us feel uncomfortable, then we start coining it a behavior, right? Now, I challenge you to think that the person with dementia is responding to a reality that we can't necessarily perceive. When we start making an individual another, right? When we start thinking that people with dementia are the only ones that exhibit behaviors, it becomes very exotic and confusing. I say let's normalize this concept of behavior, right? We all exhibit behaviors, and the person with dementia is simply responding to a reality that we necessarily cannot perceive. Dementia, Alzheimer's disease, is a disease of perception. It is not uncommon for a person with cognitive impairment to see things that aren't there, to smell things that aren't there, and to hear things that aren't there. That would be a more exclusive experience in the realm of Alzheimer's disease. Oftentimes, people with Alzheimer's want to leave their homes to a destination that may or may not be real, but they don't have the ability to come back to home base. So they may wander, which is something that most people with Alzheimer's may experience considering the longevity of their disease. There's some people with Alzheimer's that live in a belief. They're so displaced in their lives oftentimes and in their reality that they will believe or experience a very strong delusion. How that can play out is that the person who is retired and perhaps is 80 years old and has been retired for many years may truly live with the belief that they are 40 years old and must get to work. And they can live in this state for a prolonged amount of time. And their anxiety then is going to revolve around getting to work for perhaps a very important meeting. So they can live in a delusional state for a period of time. Also, people with dementia, especially Alzheimer's disease, may experience the sensation of paranoia. There is such disorientation associated with Alzheimer's disease that they may become very fearful and paranoid and think that someone is trying to harm them. So that the medications the care provider is attempting to dispense can be poisonous or threatening to me. Or I may think that people are stealing from me all the time. Where is my very important stuff? And if you and I are the only people in the house, and I know I don't have it, or I think I don't have it because I have memory impairment, who am I going to direct my anger to? Well, the other individual in the home. The care provider, the family member, the friend that's trying to assist me. And so that paranoia can become a strong part of the disease as well. What I propose is that really behavior is an attempt to communicate something that I don't have the executive function to process or communicate anymore. When we feel people without impairment, when we feel anxious, when we feel agitated, when we experience fear, we try to use our cognition to place those feelings and to decide how to display those feelings as much as we can. So if I become extremely anxious in my office, I probably am not going to start running around in a tizzy, you know, crying out or something like that, because that wouldn't be appropriate. Let me place these feelings, and I understand that it's probably not appropriate to do that at the workplace. Now, people with Alzheimer's disease don't have that amount of executive function available to them. The reason, the logic, the emotional processing is not there for them in the way that it is for us. And discussing how they feel becomes very, very difficult. And so that individual is going to feel what they feel when they feel it, no matter where they are. And they're going to find ways to communicate how they feel. Not necessarily with language all the time, perhaps with my body, perhaps with my actions, because that's what I have available to me at the time. So when someone is exhibiting quote-unquote a behavior, we have to try to think, what message are they giving me? What are they trying to tell me that their disease no longer allows them to process with language? For the most part, people with Alzheimer's disease, interestingly enough, they really don't exhibit extreme behavioral changes. Sometimes we exacerbate the behaviors that they're experiencing, however. And so a small issue, because of us, unfortunately, can become a very, very big issue. And there's ways that we can mitigate that. There's also that person with Alzheimer's disease that kind of likes to sit down all the time and watch TV and says no to everything. You want to be cautious, because just because they're not doing something sensational doesn't mean that they're content. You have to check in. You have to check in with the extremely agitated person, and you also have to check in with the person that seems relatively calm. We have to be the conduit for them to express their feelings sometimes. We have to be the ones to pull it out. Some of the causes of behavior are pretty much in line with what makes us change our behavior. Now, our environment, the place that we're in at the moment, affects how we feel and what we do. That's why I keep on going back to the example of the workplace, of church, of home, of the restaurant, because all of those different types of environments are going to guide our behavior by these unspoken social contracts. Now, if you're in a room that is extremely hot, what are you generally going to want to do? You're going to want to leave the room, start taking off clothes, right? Pretty much whatever's going on in that room doesn't matter, except for the extreme heat that you feel. The same thing as if it were cold. If you're in a room and your body can't stop shivering, it doesn't matter what's going on in the room, you cannot not think about how cold you are. So our surroundings are going to guide, in part, how we feel, no matter what else is going on. It's true for us, and it's also true for people with Alzheimer's disease. Now, if a room is very cold, I can get up and ask for a blanket. I can put on my coat. There's ways I can mitigate that feeling. A person with Alzheimer's disease may not have that sequential thinking or that reason and logic available to them. So they're simply going to respond to the cold, and they're not going to know how to alleviate the cold that they feel. They may become upset. They may get agitated. They may constantly try to leave the room. Cold bathroom, anyone? Cold bathroom in the winter? Who wants to bathe in a freezing bathroom? Probably nobody. Well, guess what? People with Alzheimer's disease are very reluctant to bathe in a freezing bathroom. However, because of the task, we push on, but we know it's not an enjoyable experience, right? Our bodies guide how we feel. When we are in pain, the only thing we can think about is pain. And we really can't do much until we alleviate that for ourselves. If I have a migraine, I probably don't want to go get my hair cut. If I'm thirsty or hungry, I probably am not going to be able to engage in a 2, 3, 4 hour long activity or excursion. We have to address our body's needs before we can move on. And the good thing is that everybody in this room presumably has enough capacity that you can address your own needs appropriately. Understand that a person with Alzheimer's disease doesn't have the ability to do that. When there is a bodily need, once again, they may try to communicate that to you through their actions, through their behaviors. Now, the challenging one about what can affect somebody's behavior is the us. Believe it or not, we can affect the way a person with Alzheimer's disease behaves. We can exacerbate what they're experiencing, right? Sometimes not being emotionally available for the person with dementia because what we're experiencing becomes most present in the interaction. And in a normal dynamic, in a normal friend or family dynamic, it's a give and take. My mother is there for me, I'm there for my mother. But when you're in a dynamic or when you're in an interaction with the person with dementia, that sense of perception of someone else's needs and the empathy is not there. They won't necessarily be able to meet your needs in the interaction. As a matter of fact, the more needs you express, the more confused, agitated, or fearful they may become. They know the emotion is present, they just don't understand why. So they know someone is angry, they just can't discern why that could be. It must be me. They know someone is angry, they may feel that they're being threatened, and they're either going to want to flee the situation, or they're going to want to protect themselves, right? And if we try to use reason and logic, then we start going down this kind of, this rabbit hole that's not going to get us to our goal. So we have to be cautious and prepared to interact with the person with dementia with the understanding that the dynamic that existed is probably not going to take place anymore, and they're not going to be there to meet my needs the way they were before because they have a disease of perception. And they can't perceive life from my point of view, right? What do we do when people have Alzheimer's disease? What do we do when people have Alzheimer's disease? Well, sometimes the reaction is to pretend that nothing's wrong. People with Alzheimer's disease begin to get told what to do a lot. A lot. Very early on in the disease. That lack of control, that lack of listening on our part can truly build up to an emotional storm. And the person can very quickly begin to respond to us in a negative way because as the caregiver, be it the family caregiver, the professional caregiver, they see us as the one taking away their control. And we force them to start doing things. We stop asking them to do things or getting their input to do things, wherever their input can be, depending on the stage. So if control is being taken away from me, and my life is out of control and my disease is very disconcerting to me, I may live in a state of fear. I don't understand what's going to happen from moment to moment. No one is asking me, no one is checking in with me, and no one seems to care. So that builds up. It's not something that's momentary. It's an emotional state that begins to affect someone's life throughout the longevity of their disease. Right? Now, because I may exist in this very negative emotional state, well then, I really don't have a lot of words to describe to you how I feel to begin with, right? So to sum it up, as your disease progresses, choice is being taken away from you, control is being taken away from you, people aren't checking in to see how you're doing. And as an adult, we all want control over our lives. That does not change in anybody's Alzheimer's or dementia. It generally doesn't. We struggle for the control, but our disease doesn't make us aware of the safety needs we now have. In the middle stage, understand that I have a disease that does not allow me to remember, I forget. I have a disease that does not allow me to remember, I forget. And when you try to make my disease present, I'm simply not going to believe you. It's not going to make sense. So if you tell me, well, Mom, I have to take over all of your credit cards and your banking now because you have Alzheimer's disease. Well, I think that's rife for a behavior to occur. That's rife for a sensational moment to pop up. You're telling me I have something, and yet as the caregiver, you're not acknowledging that I have it. Why would you expect me to remember I have Alzheimer's disease? If I have Alzheimer's disease. Yeah. Now, I'm speaking about behaviors and things like that in a fairly negative light because I want to address the more sensational things that can happen. Behaviors can be wide and varied. There's some people that develop a fear of the bathroom. Right? It's not necessarily sensational, it's not necessarily combative, but it's going to impact their life and the caregiver's life. There's some people that continue to want to cook well after the kitchen is an unsafe place for them. Well, when it comes to behaviors, there's a scope and severity to consider. You have to really take a step back and pick your battles. Think about what's going on. And think about if this is a problem that I have to solve, or is this simply an effect of somebody's dementia and the progression of their dementia? You want to think, well, if I accept the fact that we all exhibit behaviors, and they're based on these factors such as the environment, our bodies, or an outside influence, well, then let me see where this behavior is coming from. If the person is fearful of the bathroom, let me look at the bathroom through their eyes. Is the bathroom a place where bad things happen, where people are forcing me to bathe? Is the bathroom extremely cold? Does the bathroom have objects in it that I find threatening? Right? So now, if I accept that, I'm not going to force the person to go into the bathroom. I'm going to adapt the bathroom to their perception. And the problem can truly be solved. Now, if the person wants to continue cooking and it's no longer safe for them to do so, well, I may shy away from having 20-minute explanations of why they can no longer cook and simply make the kitchen a safer place. Maybe I'm not going to leave out all the knives on the butcher block. Maybe I'm going to stick them under the counter. Maybe I'm going to put some sort of locking device on the stove so the flame can't be easily turned on. Maybe I'm going to leave things that they can do lying around, right? Maybe the person would like to prepare a cheese platter or a fruit platter, and that can be easily done by leaving apples and cheese where they can find it. And the person can perform a cooking function. It really depends, and we can kind of go all over the place with it, right? Then you get to take a step back and say, well, did this easy intervention work or did it not work? You know, in a way, the good and bad thing of working with a person with Alzheimer's disease is that Alzheimer's is unfortunately a progressive disease, and their behaviors will change. So what they're experiencing today, which may seem or may be an unsolvable behavior, could change a couple of weeks down the line simply because their disease has progressed. So I always discuss with family members, there's a spectrum, a scope and severity to behavior. Some things are so what? Some things are dangerous, right? Keep this scale in mind when you're trying to change the way a person with dementia is behaving. And I suggest we throw out change and just think of manage. Don't think you can change a person with dementia's behavior. You can manage the behavior. Also, I'd shy away, as Barbara said, from arguing with a person with dementia, because we argue based on reason and logic, a brain function that a person with dementia may not necessarily have available in the same way. So some of the things that I put on my so what list are, well, wearing mismatched socks, or just wearing clothing that the person generally wouldn't wear to begin with. So sometimes our family members or friends are very spiffy dressers, and they have a lot of stuff on. You know, their brooches and their rings and their hats and their scarves and things like that. You know, that person always really put together an outfit. But in their Alzheimer's life, in their Alzheimer's experience, they may not want to do that. It may become too difficult. They may not recognize the clothing. Their body could hurt them in a way that the clothing kind of, you know, bothers them as well. And they may want to wear cotton more often than polyesters or silk or whatever, or their suits that they used to wear before. Now, often family members will argue with the person with dementia and will dress them in the same exact clothes that they always dressed in. And in a way, they think they're honoring who the person was. In a way, they're holding on to who the person was. But I say, let the person with dementia or Alzheimer's disease wear whatever is comfortable for them. This is not a quote-unquote behavior that requires our intervention. Pick your battles. If the person begins eating with their hands, let them enjoy their food with their hands, please. Alzheimer's disease is a total body disease. I will lose fine motor skills. You may start asking me to hold a fork or a spoon or a knife, and I just don't have the dexterity to do that. So now instead of focusing on the delicious food I have in front of me, I have to worry about you yelling at me to use my fork all the time. It's a so what behavior. It's an unfortunate side effect of the progression of the disease. Let them enjoy their food. Repetition. Family members call us all the time and they ask us, how do I get my dad or my mom or my aunt to stop telling me the same thing time and time again? It happens, right? It happens. And then we build up all of these negative feelings, and our stress is too acute, and it starts spilling out in ways that we prefer it doesn't spill out. Unfortunately, I have dementia. My brain gives me what my brain gives me. We're going to talk a little bit about the opportunity to redirect someone, but I've never been able to solve someone's repetition. It's a very, very strong symptom of the disease. As they progress, maybe they'll remember something else and they'll forget that. But I can't guarantee anyone that there is one method to get them to stop singing the same song over and over again, or telling you the same stories over and over again, or asking you what time it is over and over again. Now, on the other side of the spectrum, we have things that can become very dangerous to a person with Alzheimer's disease, namely managing their own medications. It's one of the kind of burning questions we get on our helpline all the time. When do I start managing mom or dad's medications, right? When do I stop letting mom and dad drive? Right? When do I bring a caregiver into the home because they can't be by themselves? You want to be cautious. People fight for control, but they lack safety awareness. There is language and methods that you can use to cushion these transitions, right? But unfortunately, we do have to make these transitions oftentimes for them. So you want to take that into account. Fairly early on in the disease, memory and abstract thinking become difficult. So people with Alzheimer's disease may not be able to drive. Their reflexes aren't available. Their sense of direction isn't available. Oftentimes, seniors don't take two medications. They don't take three medications. They'll take 8 to 12 medications. Now, asking a person to recall the way they have to take that is too difficult. And we have to start coming up with remedies to alleviate some of that and meet the person where they're at. They may recall to open Monday's pill box, but please don't ask them to separate all of the bottles of medication and put Monday together. Oops. So some of these interventions are very reminiscent of what Barbara discussed. We're asking everybody to slow down. Slow down. We have an early stage center at CaringKind, and people who are independent can travel there, socialize, join a support group, join an activity group, kind of do whatever they want. And even early on in the disease, they report to us that thinking becomes a physical task. Thinking becomes hard, and it'll make them tired. And if we ask them to think too much, they'll shut down, they'll get agitated, they'll feel stressed. And anyone in the room, if you're stressed, you make bad decisions. It's just the way our brain functions. Our cognition suffers when we don't feel good. So people with Alzheimer's disease often report that they're asked to do so much because we can't see the progression of the disease in the early stage that well, that they'll just feel taxed thinking. So we ask that you slow down. Interestingly enough, we spoke a lot about behaviors before in terms of how a person may feel and what ability they have to communicate how they feel. And we want to have a discussion based on reason and logic when the person with dementia is trying to discuss their needs. I ask that you respond to the emotional message of what they're trying to convey, not necessarily the reason and logic. Has anyone in the room ever heard an "I want to go home"? Has anyone in the room ever heard "Where's my mother," perhaps? Yeah, yeah. These are visceral concepts. The person with Alzheimer's or dementia may not necessarily want to feel their mother present, but maybe they're experiencing a sensation of loneliness. Maybe they're asking you for security or comfort, which oftentimes is what home and mom represents to us. Listen for that. You know you can't give mom. You know you may not be able to produce the home that they're discussing, but you can give a sense of security. You can convey love. You can convey support. And that sometimes will help alleviate whatever it is they're experiencing. Once we've touched on that emotional message, once we've tried to validate whatever it is they feel, well, we have an opportunity to change their world a little bit. If I make a person feel better, I may be able to move them on to another topic. So they're not asking me what time it is all the time. So they're not asking me for their mother that I can't produce or the home that I can't produce. If I give them a sense of security and of support, well, then we can move on to something better. We have the opportunity to make their brain a better offer, as one of our trainers describes it. Choice is the imperfect science, and family members often struggle with this. How much choice do I give someone? How many choices do I take away? Give yourselves permission to fail. It is not going to be perfect. I often tell my professional caregivers that if a person is exhibiting a behavior and you try to intervene 10 times and you are successful 7 of those 10 times, you have had a wonderful day. We have to understand that oftentimes what is occurring is not necessarily an effect of the person with dementia. They can't control it. It's not an effect or a reflection of our efforts. It's an effect of their disease. And we know that with Alzheimer's disease, as you discovered this morning, is a disease of peaks and valleys. It fluctuates. People's capacity fluctuates, and the choice that you can offer them also must fluctuate. Be flexible. That's the best way to conceptualize it. Give the person control wherever it is you can give them control, and that's going to vary as well. A person in early stage may well be able to control their finances sometimes. Not always, but sometimes. So when someone receives the diagnosis, we don't automatically have to take away the checkbook, right? If a person is in middle stage, and maybe they don't want to bathe that day, well, we may not have to forcibly bathe them. We can allow them that choice within the spectrum that we discussed before of so what and of danger. And when we give a person control, it generally makes them feel good. Someone is listening to me and someone is respecting my choices. So give choice where you can give choice. I touched a little bit on validate before, but I want to hone in on that. Validation or responding to somebody's emotional message is something that we do all day long. We do it with our friends and family members. We don't think of it in terms of, oh, I'm validating someone right now, right? But we do it. It's the way we cultivate our relationships. So if a friend is in distress, oftentimes we'll take a moment and listen to their distress, acknowledge what they're feeling, and join them. Make them feel not so alone in whatever's going on. With people with Alzheimer's disease, it's a little bit more difficult because we cannot respond to their reality. We may not really understand what they're reacting to. However, if a person is exhibiting signs of distress, anxiety, fear, it doesn't matter what's causing it. It doesn't matter. Respond to the anxiety, the stress, the fear, and they will feel listened to and they will feel better. It's actually fairly normal human communication. If your best friend comes to you and they're very distressed and crying, usually you're not gonna offer them a cookie first thing. It would be a little bit weird. I'm crying, I'm in distress. I'm discussing a very difficult emotional moment. Why are you offering me a cookie? All too often we do that with people with Alzheimer's disease. We jump the gun. We want to do the redirection so it goes away, but we've left them with all of these emotions that have no place to go. Validate first, redirect second. And we're going to talk a little bit about how to start an activity in a moment. I also discuss with family members, more so than professional caregivers, therapeutic fibbing. That's a little difficult sometimes too. Because the person is deeply forgetful, because they have a disease that alters their perception of reality, they may respond to things that are no longer available to them. They may respond to things that we cannot see, hear, touch, or taste. And we have to be cautious with promising people something that we can't deliver. And there's a spectrum of this, much like safety and danger. I don't know, even as a family member, if I would ever promise mom if I can't ever produce mom. So if a person with dementia is asking for their mother, I don't know if I'm going to say she's coming over later. That's dangerous. That's dangerous because I know I cannot produce that person. They're not coming over later. So when you try to push a behavior to the side with a quick fib, try to think, is this going to come back? am I breaking their trust? Is this going to cause a more acute incident later on? I may have to use that little formula now and massage the issue now rather than using a therapeutic fib. Right? I hope that resonates. Questions, please. I'm going to try to pass around a mic. This is, oh, but I need two mics.
Hi. The two of us here, we work with individuals who have developmental disabilities, like Down syndrome and intellectual disability, from profound to moderate. And right now we're seeing a couple individuals with suspected dementia. And my question is, can we expect to see the same pattern of deterioration or decline, and also are there specific services within CaringKind that are specifically geared towards that population? And is there anything else you would add in terms of like support that we can kind of build in for the individuals that we work with?
Okay. Oh, wow. That's a lot. Sorry. Okay. So it's interesting because one of the things you learn early on when you deal with people with Alzheimer's disease is that if you've seen one person with Alzheimer's disease or a cognitive impairment, you've seen one person with Alzheimer's disease and cognitive impairment. We speak in terms of generalities, but there is a wide range of symptoms and behaviors that may occur. Now, these symptoms or behaviors may or may not be exacerbated depending on whatever co-chronic condition the person has in their bodies to begin with. Now, if you're working with people with developmental disabilities, that comes with its own host of communication challenges to begin with. What I suggest, and I've noticed this in my trainings as I train professional caregivers, is that the way people are encouraged to respond to individuals with developmental disabilities is to strongly encourage their independence and choice. However, when we add the kind of icing on the cake of Alzheimer's, now they have very limited or perhaps altered ability to exercise choice and independence, and it can become very two confusing messages. I was historically taught to give independence, but now you're telling me I shouldn't. One of the things I encourage you to do is to send some staff to CaringKind for training. Although we don't have a particular group for people with developmental disabilities and Alzheimer's disease, we can provide staff that care for people with developmental disabilities another spectrum of information in terms of care. Did that answer your question? I lost track. Yeah? Was there another part to that question?
Are there other specific supports that we can put in place for them?
I would encourage you, I would certainly encourage you to call CaringKind, and perhaps we have the opportunity to tailor what kind of support it is you're talking about depending on the individuals that you're caring for. If you've seen one person with Alzheimer's, you've seen one. And I hesitate to speak in terms of generalities. I hope that's helpful. Yeah. We have a question there. Sorry, hold on one second.
Hi, my question is, what outreach efforts have been made to the medical profession on educating them on the person who has dementia? And the reason why I asked that question is, in your slides, it stated that you should not test or quiz people with dementia, as it will frustrate them. Mm-hmm. And the second point was that you shouldn't give too much information at once. And I can't tell you how many times I've been with my father on medical appointments, and the first thing they'll say is, what's your name? What's the date?
Yeah.
Give us your date of birth. How many children?
Yeah.
And that's doing the complete opposite of what you're saying. And also in the rehabilitation setting, they'll give commands where they're given four or five different things to do at once. Mm-hmm. And so my concern is that, yes, you're training, like, you know, caregivers to know all these mm-hmm. things, but it seems to me the medical profession don't have a clue.
Yeah. Yeah, I think you're making a statement more so than a question. And yes, I agree with you. There are many medical professionals who are not well-versed on communicating with a person with Alzheimer's or dementia. And also, in our medical profession in general, time isn't taken. With us, let alone with somebody with cognitive impairment, they tend to do these mini mental exams to try to get a sense or gauge someone's level of capacity. What I've often told family members to do is before you take your person to the doctor, you need to get the doctor on the phone and cushion that visit. If there is a particular trigger the person with Alzheimer's has, the doctor needs to know not to do that. People with Alzheimer's will become frustrated, will feel that the doctor is intruding, will not recall who the doctor is or why they have to answer those questions. So as best we can try to cushion those visits to the doctor and see what success you have with that individual physician. But yes, I agree with you. Unless you spend time educating yourself and practicing the communication techniques, they're not going to be available. That's the best that I got. So I agree with you.
Hi.
Hi.
Hello?
Okay,
there you go. Hi. I noticed in the dementia population, when the later the stages, the more the disease advances, there seems to be like an increase or a change or worsening of behaviors. And I've noticed that a lot, like some caregivers are very resistant in terms of using medication to manage those behaviors. Would CaringKind use this as a recommendation? Because I know it wasn't brought up in the slides about medication.
Yeah, yeah. Well, oftentimes what we do at CaringKind is encourage behavioral interventions prior to looking into medications. It is true. There is a small population of people with cognitive impairment that can benefit from medication management from their behaviors. But our concern is that family members oftentimes, or care partners, or professional caregivers are not attempting the behavioral interventions first. So it's all too often I hear, the person with dementia hits me when I try to give them a bath. Well, have you discovered why? Well, they have dementia. You see, that's the wrong way to think about it, right? Is there something in their environment? Is there something in their body? Or is there something that we're doing that's encouraging that aggressive behavior? So what we find is that people are perhaps too quick to go to medication sometimes without trying the behavioral intervention. So if you come to one of our seminars, if you call our helpline, we're going to suggest behavioral interventions before we start discussing medication.
I had a question. I had a question about the earlier comment on vision, particularly peripheral vision and whatever. And I was wondering if that's because of, along with Alzheimer's, there is something in the brain that's affecting vision in particular, and if you could elaborate upon that.
It's interesting. Our brain is not one homogeneous organ. There are specialized sections in our brain that address all of our bodily functions as well as our perception of reality. And a person's Alzheimer's disease often, or certainly, begins in the hippocampus and will start branching off to other areas of our brain. And when it starts that branching off, that area of our brain will become impaired. So it is not uncommon for people's Alzheimer's disease not only to hit the hippocampus early on, certainly the vision center as well. It affects every part of our brain eventually. And as we know, our brains control our ability to manage our bodies. So Alzheimer's disease does affect the vision center, in some people more than others, at different lengths of time, because everybody's Alzheimer's disease will develop differently. Is that helpful?
Well, I ask it because my father can read a chart. Mm-hmm. Yeah. No problem. Mm-hmm.
But yet, when we're out someplace, he has the problem. He can't see things. He doesn't.
It's interesting, there may be too much stimulation.
Or is it a covering mechanism?
No, it may be too much stimulation. When you're outside, think about it. When you're outside, you have thousands of things going on at the same time, variances in lighting, noise, the amount of people. And if I have Alzheimer's disease and my brain is impaired, I can only think about so many things all at once. And if I'm focused in the doctor's office, well, then all of the other distractions have been taken away for me. But if I'm outside, then I'm bombarded with stimulation that I may not be able to process. That may be the reason. If you have additional questions, you can always call our helpline and they can focus more one-on-one on what that means to you and him.
Hello.
Yeah.
I love all the interventions and planning and thinking ahead. My experience, personal experience, as well as experience with other people who I know who are caring for parents, is the challenge of having the privilege of time and the privilege of waiting things out, testing different strategies, because like myself, we are that sandwich generation. Some younger than I, and my, where we might still be working or working part-time, or and unfortunately, the supportive services via Medicaid for the large growing population of people that have to go to Medicaid, not because they want to, but because that's the only way they can keep mom and dad or uncle at home. Okay, so it's so frustrating because there's a part of your brain that says, yes, I want to do this and that, but the reality of you having to make a living and the or to keep working so that you can finish out your work time so that you can retire and not be in a bad place yourself. And I hear this time and time and time again, not dissimilar from younger parents with young children, that we rush to the medications. We rush to interventions that are quicker, because the rest of our lives don't allow the family to take that time. And the support systems that come via Medicare, Medicaid, or even private insurance do not recognize Alzheimer's and other dementias in the same way they recognize physical disabilities. They're still supporting along the lines of, can the person walk to the bathroom? Can the person do this? Then we can authorize this type of support or that type of support. And I know we're not here for advocacy, but I think a lot needs to be done in the area of advocacy of our politicians and the state health department to recognize the dementias as needing care that is similar, not similar, like physical disabilities.
Yeah. Agreed, yeah. People with Alzheimer's disease all too often require what's called support and supervision, and it becomes very, very difficult to get a health insurance provider to cover the cost of direction and supervision, that sort of support. It's interesting because we always say that it takes a team of people to take care of a person with Alzheimer's disease. One person cannot do it for any great length of time by themselves. It truly does take a team. And family members, everyone in the audience, family members and professionals alike, find themselves cobbling services together to try so that the person is supervised for the great majority of the day. And it's a concern that we recognize. And we do have an advocacy component to CaringKind that is interested in legislation, long-term care legislation. In addition, we have a social work department that tries to assist family members with this type of care planning and case management. It's very difficult. Yes, I agree with you.
Yeah, hi. My name is Luz Acevedo. I'm from the Brooklyn Public Library. And the program that you're talking about, the services, is wonderful. But if people don't know about it, we do. But there's a lot of people that need the services. So at Brooklyn Public Library, what we do is we provide information on the services that you have to the community and to those that are, sometimes there's a denial, you know. Doctors, you go to the doctor, they tell you about your condition, but they don't tell you anything else. So at Brooklyn Public Library, we are willing to work with you and continue collaborations. So please send us information because we have 60 branches where we can distribute the information that you're providing here.
Thank you for that. And yes, I do have your card from earlier today. So thank you, Luz. Yeah. Okay, so we have one more question. Just stay there, take this. I'll take that one.
Okay, earlier this morning on the chart it said that Alzheimer's is fatal.
That it decreases brain size by killing neurons and increases the spaces in between that our brain has with the plaques that build up. So the deterioration can become so acute that our brains can no longer support the functioning of our body. Does that make sense? Okay.
Because my mom stopped eating, period. She didn't know how to chew, she didn't know how to swallow.
Oh, we have one more question.
Okay. One more. Hi. We're a group here. We run a day program for seniors with dementia. And one of our most common issues is getting to the bathroom.
Yeah. What do you mean by that?
Having them get up and say, you need to go to the bathroom.
So you want the person with dementia to recognize when they have to go to the bathroom and alert somebody, or?
No, just, you know, I mean, we try to, when they, you know, some of them get bussed in, and when we get there, we try to encourage them that they may need to go to the bathroom, but they're not aware of it,
yeah.
Or they don't know how to, you know, understand it, mm-hmm. Or they just deny it, or they refuse to go.
That's where we play around with language and choice. One of the things that we were trying to hone in on with communication is that when you discuss something, let them know the activity is happening, but give them choice within the activity. So it's not a question of do you want to go to the bathroom or do you want to eat or do you want to go out. It's a question of would you like bacon or eggs? Do you want to go to the park or do you want to go to the store? You can simply make a declarative sentence sometimes, and this could be helpful, of say, let's go to the bathroom, right? And so we're letting them know what activity is going to happen and provide them with choice, if you can, within that activity. Sometimes the question is so broad, they really don't understand the sequence of events that has to unfold to accomplish it, and I will shut down. Would you like to go outside? Means that my brain has to think of way too many things to affect that outside. So I'm going to say no. Right? What would you like to eat today presents so many choices that I may instantly become overwhelmed and I'm going to say I'm not hungry. Right? Also, we can't discount the memory impairment. I just ate or I just went to the bathroom. So sometimes a declarative sentence can help within that. Let's go. That could be helpful. If anyone has individual questions that they need addressed, because we have such a limited amount of time, please, everyone, call our helpline, 646-744-2900. And we have helpline counselors ready to delve into some of these things that you're experiencing and help you piece together what's happening at the time and what's happening in the home to come up with some helpful suggestions. Thank you all. You were a tremendous audience. Great questions. Oh, I'm sorry. We have one more presentation that's going to be discussed, activities.
Mm-hmm. How is everybody today? Okay. Oh, my name is Juan Carlos Rojas, and I am Spanish dementia care trainer at CaringKind, el Centro del Cuidado para el Alzheimer's. In Spanish, I am bilingual. Okay, my first language is Spanish. English is not my second. And I want to excuse my accent, and I want to excuse my cold. I'm having a cold, so I will try to communicate the best I can, and you want to put your best to try to understand what I'm my exposition, okay? I would like for everybody to think about any activity that you have done today. Anybody? I would love for everybody to participate here, please. Eating, she was eating. Another person? Shopping, she was shopping before to come to this big event. This is a big activity. I want for everybody to think about any activity that we have accomplished all this day. Getting dressed, morning preparation, brushing our teeth, comb our hair, ¿verdad? Sorry. Okay. Showering, shaving for guys, it's very difficult, you know? It's very easy. We do things and we take a granted that they are there. We go to the bathroom, we just jump in the shower, and we just do millions of things with a normal brain. But when our brain is affected for the dementia, is when we start thinking about how much we have lost. It's very difficult and frustrating sometimes for somebody with dementia to try to reach a goal and be something that can be very impossible for them to them. So today we're going to talk engaging with a person with dementia to do some activity, to do something to help them all day through. Activities are good activities, things that we like to do, that we can have fun. Another, we have to do every day. We have to get dressed every day. We have to wash our face every day, and we have to wash our hands in the winter to don't get sick like me. But like I said before, in a normal brain, we don't think about this until we lost the ability. Sometimes for a person with dementia to go through, just to go to the process to brush their teeth is a big, big thing. The lady was asking a question about, how hard is for them to bring the person with dementia to the bathroom? It's a big thing. It's so many things involved there. So, but after the person went to the bathroom or after the person had a shower, let's think, how do you feel after taking a shower, even in a cold day? You feel refreshed, you feel new, you feel a little energetic. So there are so many benefits that the person with dementia and us as a professional or family caregivers, we can benefit if we try to follow some little steps. Okay? So let's see, what is an activity? Activity is any interaction that we have with a person. Activity is anything. You are active. You are active person. You are active in this church. You are active because you go to the gym. You have your routine. Okay? So each of these encounters, as I said before, that can be very rewarding for a person with dementia and for us as a caregivers. The people with the dementia may experience a lack of stimulation. Sometimes, I'm sure you heard a lot this morning, people with dementia, they lose their desire to do anything. They don't want to do anything. Barbara was saying, don't ever ask if they want to do, because if I have dementia, I don't want to do anything. I do not want to do anything. I don't know. So I cannot have a stimulation. And you, as my caregiver, keep asking me to do something, or you are not giving me enough stimulation to do something. I can be overstimulated. You need for me to go to the doctor. You need to bring me to the doctor. You want for me to hurry up. And you, let's put this. It's your birthday. I am your daddy. So your sons are coming to the party, and you are so happy. Daddy, you have to get ready. It's going to be this person here, and Uncle Sam is going to be here, and you have to be ready. So it's overstimulation for me. Hmm? You maybe try to stimulate me, to give me stimulation and things I don't really care, because if I have dementia, that doesn't mean I have a past life too, and that doesn't mean I had to like everything that you like. I have my past. I like to talk to people. I like to socialize. So as soon as I got my diagnosis, you say to me, you know, Daddy, you just repeat too much. Don't talk, don't talk. You locked me. Yes, we do that because we feel a little weird. But, and you try to put me in situation that I don't really care. I like to do what I want. This is what I like to do all my life, all my past. This is all what I did. So you can bring me this invitation to do something in the wrong time of my day. Maybe you want to give me a bath at 5 in the morning because you have to leave the work. Yes, you had to leave work at 8 and I had to be bathed. So, and you have one room with 15 people here and you want to give me a bath in your convenience. It's good. I had to bathe 15 guys. So, Mr. Rojas, you turn the lights on, get there, give me a very wrong message for me. I am sleeping. I am having a very nice dream. You interrupt my dream, and you come here in the wrong time to give me the wrong command and pretend, and you want for me to do what you want. Yes? And of course, in the speed, because you need to have this done, and I can't, and you don't really care about me. How can I feel as a person with dementia? Minimize. I don't have anything to do. I don't have anything to say. Most you absorb, or the person who is giving me instructions is minimizing me. I don't have options because I am sleeping and you woke me up. So frustration, of course, how you will feel if you don't want to go because you, if you don't want to eat because you have a pain and I am forcing you to eat. Yes, how you as a human being, you're going to feel forced to do something. Frustration, angry, insecure, and of course my self-esteem is going to be totally down as a human being. What is happening here? The first thing that we should look is knowing the person. knowing me as your patient, as your brother, as your father, as the person with dementia, what I really like, what I really dislike, because I really like to take a shower after 3 o'clock in the afternoon because it's warm, it's clear, it's light there, and it's easy for me. I don't like to be rushed. I don't like to be told what I have to do. And normally, it's me or somebody, sorry. And normally, I've been told to do this and this and this. Eat this, don't eat this, don't move here, don't. This is our, sometimes the reactions I have from people as a person with dementia. So if you know that I dislike that people buzz me, try to don't buzz me. So be aware of how I feel today. Maybe I have a very bad dream last night. Maybe I slept only 2 hours. Look, I'm having a cold. Be a little conscious of how I feel physically. About my emotions, maybe I am so sad and I don't know how, I don't know why I am so sad. So if you are aware about my emotional and physical state, things can change. We can do things better. Because as Amy before, she was talking about validation. If you see me sad, be aware that I am sad, and at least ask me why you are sad, even if I don't answer, but somebody recognize that I am a little down today. So don't forget to try to understand in which stage I am. I can be in early stage, I can be in a middle stage, or I can be in the late stage. So according to that, it's going to be our connection. Based on this, how much I'm going to be able to afford to the task or to the activity that you are putting me on. And we talked before about the environment. What is the environment offering? Too much distractions, peace, the environment I like. Or maybe you think I want to go to the movie. I love to go to the movie. And you want to bring me to the movie, and let's say I am in my early stage. And I love to go to the movie, but be prepared, because as soon as I get to the movie theater and everything is dark, I get scared, and I want to run away from there. So be prepared always for me for plan A, B, C, D, and X, because we had to be prepared. So what we need, when I am in early stage, what do I need from you as my caregiver, as the person who take care of me? I want to need for you to try to maintain my independence as much as I can. Help me try to be the same person I was before. If I like to go to the church, even if you don't profess my religion, let's go to the church. I enjoy doing that. You can bring me to the theater in early stage, to the stadium if I like baseball. But don't bring me because I don't understand baseball. So, museum, you can bring me to the museum. But in a person with dementia can enjoy an activity in their early stage all the way to the late stage. They can have fun. They can have a little peace moment there. And we're gonna talk about this a little later. So take me to educational classes. Let me socialize. Let me be part of this. Everybody's taking from me. Like she said, they are taking my money. They are taking my kids, I can't drive anymore. Mm? And plus, I have somebody here in my home I don't want, which somebody that I don't need. So try to maintain my independence as much I can. I had experience. I do family caregiver workshop for Spanish, no society or Spanish population. Yeah. And it was a gentleman. And you can see how much he loves his wife. She was just diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease. And he really loves his wife. And he was like, she was moving from one room to the other, and he was following her because it's the fear that he explained to me. I don't want to lose her. I want for her to be safe every little second now when she's here. And it's normal because we are human. We love. He loves his wife. He wants to protect her every second. But in the other side, she wasn't able to get dressed because he dressed her. She was sitting in the toilet, and he was with her. She loves to cook, and he was in the kitchen. She wasn't allowed to go to the kitchen. She wasn't allowed to go do this. No, everything was a big no. How would you feel if somebody put you in this situation? How are you going to feel? We're going to feel all what we talk about, angry, minimize our self-esteem. And we want to start presenting some behaviors that maybe, or some behaviors that maybe you don't like. Amy explained about behavior. Sometimes we provoke the behaviors. So this is so wrong in the early stage. Even if the husband loves his wife, let's help her, let's walk with her every room. We can watch the person from here, let them do whatever they want to do, whatever they feel they can do. Like Amy said, don't take the wallet immediately. Wallet for me means I have $10 in my wallet. If I got lost in the street, I can make a call. I can buy a sandwich if I am hungry. I can go somewhere. I can call a taxi. But if you take everything from me, I don't feel secure. I don't feel nothing. So try to maintain their independence as much as you can in the person in the middle, in the early stage. Then after, in the middle stage, the big key is here. I'm going to need your help to do everything because for the disease, I don't know how to start one thing, one activity. You want for me to sing a song and say, sing for me that song, the Beatles. Let it be. If you don't start to sing the song with me, I won't get it. So try to engage me in the activity. In the middle stage, I'm sorry, you're gonna have to keep me busy all the time. I need to be busy. I need to do stuff. With your assistance, yes, you're gonna help me to move. You want to mention to me where is the bathroom. You want to help me to go to the bathroom. You want to let me brush my teeth. I don't want for you to do for me. But sometimes it's easy. Sometimes it's easy to give feeder because I am really late for the appointment and you had to eat. What about her as a person in the middle stage? So in the middle stage, there are so many things I can do, but everything had to be modified according to my abilities and my emotional and physical state. So in the middle stage, I can go visit family. Even I can go to the park. I can go for walks. I can go to these adult daycare center programs. I can do a lot of art, more than you think. More than you think. I can enjoy music. And you know I like to dance. I can dance too. I can help you doing the dishes. We can do the dishes together, and we can go to the bedroom, and we can set up in the bed the way I like, not the way you like. Because of course, you return something from this morning and give me the choice. Do you want this pillow here or there? And I'm gonna say, I want this pillow here. And you're gonna say, well, it looks different, but it's okay, it's your choice. It's very nice. It really looks nice. If you give me this little applause by the end, saying I did very good work, my self-esteem is gonna come back a little. Who doesn't feel, how do you feel when somebody appreciates what you're doing? You did a very good job. You look really great today. Thank you for doing this for me. So I can do so many things. I want to share, before I was a trainer, I was taking care of so many people with dementia and with Alzheimer's. I went to a home where when I got interviewed with the family, I proposed music because I like music. I said, you know, I can do music with your mom. We can go, no, she doesn't like music. Okay, so I can do art with her. No, she never liked art. You're gonna have to talk to her. You're gonna have to take a conversation because she doesn't like to talk to us either. She hasn't talked to anybody. She's sitting there. My job is take this lady from there, put in the wheelchair and go to the restaurant and be sure that she eat and come back. It's like putting this paper from here to here and bring it back. So I took the job, and of course, if you're gonna do activity with the person with dementia, your imagination has to fly everywhere. You have to be creative. You have to be prepared to change your schedule almost all day. Because maybe I didn't give you the right smile and you didn't like the restaurant we came, so we're gonna go to the next restaurant where you feel a little better. So if I give you the right smile, yes, we want to enjoy the meal here, so it's an activity. Depending on so many things, so many, the way I present myself, the way I ask my help. Do you like for me to help you? How can I help you? My tone, my voice, my body language, all the communication key we talked before here, if we use to engage in activity, we're gonna be successful. So the lady, she didn't want to do anything. I got there, I introduced myself, I tried to be kind all the time. And I said, well, what do you like to do? Wrong question. She said nothing. And I was sitting there saying, well, and you many have sitting there, what are we gonna do? So I had to find a way to present. I think we're gonna go for lunch. Which one is your favorite restaurant? Oh, I like to go to this restaurant, I haven't been, so, oh, let's go there. How do you like to go there? So we went to the restaurant. We tried to establish a relationship with her. I was so lucky because it was very quick. So the person who wasn't doing anything, I had to find activities for her almost every second because she had so many behaviors. If I leave her alone for 1 second, she was like hallucinating. And I had to take her from here to engage her in something, to say, you know, my lady, we're gonna do this now. I have this, I was the project guy. I have so many projects. I have this project. I have a friend. I know you love to shop. I know you love to shopping. So I have a friend, it's her birthday, and you're a lady. Can you help me to buy a present for my friend? She loved to do that. So the way I present the activity, she was engaging and she said, yes, we're gonna go and we have so much fun. I didn't have any friend. We spent some money, but it was okay. She was engaging in activities. So it was a very rich lady that she never was in the kitchen. No, never. She has people, she has 12 caregivers, but she has never been in the kitchen. And one day, she didn't eat very well. So I had to put myself in and said, you know, we're gonna try to bake a cake today. I have a very good recipe. Do you think you can help me with that? It's my birthday. And it was my birthday. So she, when it comes to you, they are very close to you. They do things for you because you're gonna say thank you and they feel the same reward that we feel when they do something for us, they feel bad too. So we have 10 minutes trying to break the egg because I don't know how to crush the egg. I don't know. And I said, do you know how to do this? So she was like, I don't know, let's try with this. And so, but we have fun. To make the story short, we bake a beautiful cake. I don't know how the cake tastes because she was, but we have like 2 hours. She was engaging in the same time we were talking about laughing, having fun, remembering things, saying jokes, taking pictures. Do you like a selfish? I use my camera all the time. Do you want a selfish? Let's take a selfish cooking. So she was very engaged. She was in the cooking. So we didn't eat the cake, of course, but then we put the cake in the oven. And the oven was there, and we sit in front of the oven. And her face was like an angel when the cake raised like this. She said, it's done. Okay, we're gonna take it out. Let's take a picture at least. So it's the way that you present the activity with a person is how they're gonna do with you, that how they're gonna go with you. And I was saying, oh, whatever they can do for you, they will do. I was working for my citizenship and I bought flashcards. They have very big letters, yes. So she has so many behaviors that sometimes she started scratching and you had to keep her busy because if not, that's mean infection in dermatologies, and plus it's no good for her. So I had to keep her busy and I said, look, how do you like this? She said, what is this? He said, you know, I'm applying for this citizenship and I need to study. Do you think you can help me with this? You need to read the flashcard for me. So she was reading the flashcard for me by giving me the answer. But it's okay. What I want to say doesn't matter. It's the activity. Let's focus in the moment here. We expand. I took her from the hallucination, from the scratching, from so many. I had to remove her from there to do something that she feels great with the cake. She feels so good that I passed my citizenship. So it was, that isn't what the people need. In the late stage, it's a little difficult. It's a little difficult. And sometimes for the caregivers, it's a little, I heard that it's very easy. My lady is there sleeping all the time. She's sleeping, she doesn't talk. She doesn't even see me. so I have a lot of time to be on my phone, to do my things. But the people there need me. They can do something with you, even in those moments. They can enjoy touching. Just touching. Holding somebody's hand. Give them security. I gave this lady the fact that she wasn't alone. She was with somebody there. Having these feelings had to be very rewarding for somebody in the late stage. So in the late stage, as a person with dementia, I'm going to benefit from massage, a little touch, a little touches, aromatherapy, a little smell, because this basil remind me when I was a child, maybe bring me that emotion that I have there. Maybe you come here, you know, I am very Catholic since I was little, or I am evangelical, but I like Christian music. You come to me and start singing, even if I don't sing, and you are holding my hand, and I am singing the song for you, may I? And I am singing the song for you, she may respond with this for me, just with a little touch. And this is connection. I am helping her in the late stage. Before I finish, I want to share my last story with you. Another person with dementia. Music always helps. She was a musician, she was a singer. But in the late stage, she wasn't able to sing. But when she was a girl, she has a little drum that she played. So I don't know if you're familiar, but when the person with dementia got in the late stage, they start curving like this. They go like this, their body. So I had to put the little drum in her, between her legs. And she started like, if I start singing with her, you are my sunshine, my only sunshine, you made me. So we have this kind of connection. Her family was living outside New York, and she was in the last moment of her life, almost, when her son came over. And her son said to me, how she's doing? I said, I don't know, I think she's home. And you know why I knew? Because she was and she left. So we can give this comfort and we can give this moment to people, enjoyable moments from the early stage to the last minute. Anybody has any question? Any question? No questions. Thank you.
I have a question. You're not off the hook.
How do you find out their likes and dislikes?
Excuse me?
How do you find out a person's likes and dislikes?
How do I find?
As their care partner, how do you find out what a person with dementia would enjoy or does not enjoy?
How I find? Well, it's very obvious. They show you and they let you know when and when start and when finish. They show you when they are happy. You can see when the person engaged, and you can see when the person doesn't want to do things anymore. go there. I was in the program with the Museum of Metropolitan Art, and they have hands-on. And we went there with my lady, and I had to push every day. I said, we're gonna go just 20 minutes, and then we're gonna go back. Let's try to do some art, because I really wanna keep her busy. So we got there, sorry, and she was almost ready to go to leave. She didn't want to deal anymore. So I asked the instructor, I said, what else we can do here? She said she had to sign her work. So she put her name and she wrote D-O-N-E. And she said, I mean it. So,
they're gonna let you know if they like something or if they don't like something. Yeah.
Another question?
Yeah.
I'm gonna do it in Spanish.
It's okay. En español, sí, está bien.
Sí, ¿qué pasa si una persona, usted le muestra que usted está sabiendo que esa persona está enferma, le como que le es indiferente o le muestra que sabe o cómo lo puede ayudar?
¿Cómo es la pregunta?
Sí, sí, por ejemplo, su mamá tiene Alzheimer. His mother has Alzheimer. How, I know that she don't feel secure because something has happened to her. So should I show her that I show that I ignore that she feels that, or I say, you know, I don't know how to say it, but if she knows that I'm having trouble, because, you know, I feel sad because she's having that, she knows that she had something going in her mind. Should I show her that that I know what happened, or
person, I'm going to fill this one. If a person with cognitive impairment is expressing a sense of disorientation, how far do you go with that? How far, in terms of the acknowledgement, do you go with that? Well, the important thing to remember is that, of course, the person may be in early, middle, or late stage. Now, if the person is in early stage of their disease, I say early stage is an opportunity. Right? Not only do you have the opportunity to understand your disease, you can acknowledge it, you can share your diagnosis with whomever you choose, and you can also plan. So if somebody in the early stage is expressing a sense of disorientation and just general unease because of what they've just been told, then I would try to have a conversation with them the way I would have a conversation with anyone else. And we're going to talk about the disease as frankly as we can, pretty much using reason and logic, because they'll have that amount of self-awareness available to them. In the middle stage, it's a whole nother ball game. People may experience a strong sense of disorientation and unease. Now, I have to be cautious. One of the hallmarks of middle stage is the loss of self-awareness. This is when I have a disease that doesn't allow me to remember, I forget. And I'm going to be very cautious with how I discuss this orientation. I may not say the word Alzheimer's disease. I may choose not to go into a long, drawn-out explanation of the diagnosis. And all too often, family members start saying things like, well, Mom, if you recall, you have Alzheimer's disease, and the doctor diagnosed you 5 years ago, so you're really nervous. I get that. Shy away from that. What I stated in my presentation before is that you want to address the emotional content of the message. If someone is disoriented, they're probably trying to communicate distress, fear, and anxiety. I say in the middle stage, address the fear, disorientation, and anxiety, and try to provide comfort. Sometimes simply acknowledging and reflecting what they feel is the way to go. I'm sorry you feel this sense of disorientation. It seems like it's really bothering you. And I'm going to start my conversation that way. I'm giving the person a space to talk about how they feel with validation, right? But I'm not going to rely on their memory to do it. I'm not going to start my sentence by saying, well, remember. When you speak to a person with Alzheimer's disease or any cognitive impairment, and you start your sentence with remember, you may be asking them to do something that is physically impossible. The hallmark of Alzheimer's disease is the inability to capture new memory. And if I start my sentence with remember, I'm asking them to do something that may be physically impossible. And I'm going to use a simplistic analogy. Would anybody in the room tell a double amputee to run up the steps? Generally, we wouldn't. It's unkind, and we're also acknowledging that I can't ask them to do something that is physically impossible. They don't have that part of their body available. Well, when you speak to someone with Alzheimer's disease, especially towards the middle stage, be cautious with requiring them to remember things or asking them to remember things. You may be asking them to do something that is physically impossible, but we can help them express their emotions. We can do that. It's one of the reasons we don't like quizzing, although we know that the doctors do it all the time, right? Was that helpful? Okay. For any, and I've said this before, I'm not sure if you heard it, for any individual issues that you would like to flesh out more than what we've discussed here, don't hesitate to call our helpline. Thank you all.
A little bit ahead of schedule, and it's actually my pleasure to introduce Ryan Lynch, who is the policy director here at the Office of the Borough President, to give us a few closing remarks. And then I'll take the mic back and wrap up the day, let you know a couple of next steps that I want to make sure you're aware of. And it looks like we'll be able to get out a little ahead of schedule and you'll be able to enjoy the beautiful day. So, Ryan, thanks.
Thank you, Matt. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you all for coming to this such important event here at Borough Hall. The Borough President was unfortunate he couldn't be here today, but I'm glad that the Deputy Borough President, Diana Reyna, was here earlier. She's a fantastic advocate for all of the borough and a great partner with the borough president. And on their behalf, I just wanted to say thank you all for coming today to DFTA in their partnership, to CaringKind in partnership, and to the Stavros Niarchos Foundation. Incredible partners to work with today on this really important issue. I know the deputy spoke at length about several of the programs that we're working on here at Borough Hall with respect to public safety for seniors on our streets, from our extensive work in trying to make sure that seniors have access to technology and understand that technology so that they're not the victims of fraud or con artists, and as well as our work on our Access Friendly NYC program, which is trying to make public buildings more friendly to seniors and those with disabilities, not only from a physical landscape, but from an emotional and auditory and visual aspect as well. So we're going to continue to fight on these issues here at Borough Hall. You have a partner in Borough Hall. Anything you ever need to partner with us, I know Nan Blackshear has been an incredible partner on these issues for so long here over the course of multiple borough presidents, and we thank her for her service here. But anything you ever need from us from a policy perspective, my door is always open. My email is Ryan Lynch, RyanLynch, at brooklynbp.nyc.gov. So anytime, feel free to just reach out and we can see how we can work together to advance these important causes. With that, I don't want to take much more of your time because I know you've been here all morning, all day, but I want to turn it back over to Matt and thank him again for his incredible partnership with CaringKind, and thanks for a great day. Thank you.
So I just wanted to take an opportunity again to thank you all for spending a beautiful Friday with us. I want to let you know that the PowerPoint slides that we all worked off of today, we don't have handouts for you here, but I believe we have all of your email addresses when you registered for the conference. So what we're going to do is send out all those slides, make them available to you. And we're also in that same email going to be sending you a link to a survey that will allow you to give us some feedback on how this conference was for you. This is something that we look forward to continuing to offer in Brooklyn, in a great partnership with the Borough President's Office, certainly with the Department for the Aging. And so your feedback would be really helpful in guiding us towards next steps. So be on the lookout for the survey. Please take a minute or two to fill it out, and be sure to take the brochures that we've all handed out for you today, and please continue to take advantage of the programs and services that we provide. So again, on behalf of the Borough President's Office, DFTA, Stavros Niarchos Foundation, and of course, CaringKind, thank you all so much for spending today with us.